You can watch every bloody buck. You can watch every top 10 setting video on YouTube and still miss the things that actually make flying easier. So let's fix that. Today I show you my tiny tweaks that turn the Mini 5 Pro from good into mine. Hi guys, welcome back to our drone channel. I'm out here today at one of my favorite flying spots. Good light today. After days of rain, the winds finally calmed down and the sky is starting to open up. Before I take off, I'll show you the settings I use on my Mini 5 Pro. So it's just little things that make flying easier, the footage smoother, and the whole experience way more relaxed. Some of them are just tiny. A checkbox here, a button swap there, but once you're in the air, they change everything. So let me show you the very first things I have adjusted before my very first liftoff. One of the very first things I changed on my Mini 5 Pro was the return to home setting. And honestly, that's where a lot of people mess up. I actually learned it the hard way with my old Mini 3 Pro. I was flying down in this small valley in Spain. Looked absolutely beautiful. I hit RDH and the drone almost clipped the tree on the way back. That was a pretty close one. Since then, I've always kept my RDH height at 120 meters, which is the legal max here, and it clears basically everything. But here's the thing, the Mini 5 Pro can do it smarter. So there's a mode called Optimal RDH, and that's what I use now. Instead of just blindly climbing to 120 meters, the drone scans the surroundings and only goes as high as it needs to. So, to show you the difference, I recorded both modes. First, with a fixed 120 meters. I'm flying very low. There's just one tall tree between the home point and the position of the Mini. Maybe 25 to 30 meters height. And yet, watch this. The drone climbs all the way up to 120 meters before even turning back. Well, totally safe for sure, but it's burning time and battery for no reason. Now, same spot, same flight path, but with optimal RDH. You see it initiates the ascending, but scans the surrounding the same time. It just rises until it clears the tree, maybe 35, 36 meters, that's it. Then it goes forward to the open field and straight home. Same safety, way faster, and it saves a surprising amount of battery. It's one of those little settings that you change once and then you wonder why it's not the default. Anyway, always have an eye on it, like with each of the automated functions. So one thing I really love about the Mini 5 Pro is how smart it feels when it comes to obstacle detection. Sure, the Mini 4 Pro already had full omnidirectional sensing, but this one adds something new, LiDAR. So now it doesn't just see obstacles, it actually measures them. Even in lower light, the LiDAR system picks up the shape and distance of objects around you. I mostly keep obstacle avoidance on. You can tell by the small circle icon at the top right of the screen. When it's white, it's active. When it's red, guess what? It's off. So here's a good example. In one of my tests, I flew directly toward this old wooden hay wagon. You see in here. With brake mode, the drone stops dead in front of it. It just sits there, refusing to go any further, which is safe, sure, but not really usable when you're trying to film a smooth sequence. So now watch what happens in bypass mode with LiDAR active. I fly the exact same line, same speed, and right here, as I'm getting close, you can actually see the Mini 5 Pro detects the object and immediately builds a path around it. It slightly slides to the left, curves around the wagon, and keeps going straight ahead. And here's a second test where I am the obstacle. It's exactly doing the same, building a quick path around me. So the motion looks completely natural in the footage. No jerky stops, no strange angles. And that's what I love about bypass with LiDAR. It just makes flying feel more confident, especially when you're focused on the camera and not on dodging obstacles yourself. Alrighty, so let's talk image quality, because that's one of the first things I change before flying. My Mini 5 Pro gives me three color options. It's normal, HLG and D-Log M. And yeah, I know D-Log M looks kind of boring at first, super flat, low contrast, but that's exactly what I want. It keeps way more image data and it's the same format DJI now uses across almost everything, even their action cams. So if I'm mixing shots from my Osmo Action 4 or from the Avatar 2, everything just matches. No weird color jumps in the edit. Now, there are actually two ways to enable it. Let me show you both. Option 1. Just tap the three dots in the top right corner. Go to Camera, scroll a bit down to Color, and there you can select between the three options. We choose D-Log M. Option 2. Tap the auto icon in the lower right corner, that switches you to the pro mode. Then open the color settings down here and again choose D-Log M. Either way, once you turn it on, the screen goes kinda gray and dull. And that's where most people freak out and switch back. But don't, that's actually what it's supposed to look like. To make it easier while flying, I always activate color display assist. It gives a way more nice color in the preview again, but the recording is still flat and unprocessed. So I still see bright natural colors on screen, but the footage I record still has all that dynamic range to work with it later. In post, I just drop a simple LUT on top and boom, instantly cinematic look. I've tried HLG too, it's fine if you want quick results straight out of the camera. But for me, D-Log M just gives me more control, more consistency, and once you start grading your own footage, you'll never go back. One of the things I absolutely love about the Mini 5 Pro is that crazy 225 degree gimbal roll. It's such a cool feature. You can create these spinning interception style shots that look like something out of a chase scene. But the default control setup? Yeah, that's just painful. DJI wants us to hold C1 and turn the back dial. And honestly, unless you've got an extra thumb, that's not happening mid-flight. So I just open the menu, go to control, and then scroll a bit down to bottom customization. And here I can swap the function. Now the dial by itself controls the gimbal roll, and C1 plus dial handles zoom instead. I never really use the dial for zooming anyway, I just tap the zoom step on the screen. And man, that one change makes a huge difference. I can keep both hands steady on the sticks, roll the camera naturally and stay fully focused on the shot. The first time I tried it, I was chasing a car down the street and without even thinking, I rolled the gimbal mid-turn. When I checked the footage later, it looked absolutely insane. Pure motion, like something straight out of a car commercial. So yeah, it's a tiny tweak, but it's completely changed how you can move the camera. It's smoother, faster, and honestly, just way more fun to fly. Cruise control is another setting I use constantly, especially for cinematic tracking shots. You start flying, press the combo, and the drone just keeps its current speed and direction. Hands off the sticks. But like with the gimbal roll, the standard shortcut is kinda awkward. So we are back in the menu at bottom customization, and we put cruise control to C2, the same button that normally switches between portrait and landscape. You can still change orientation directly on the screen, so you lose nothing, but you gain lots of comfort. Now here's the cool part most people miss. Cruise control isn't just lock speed. Every time you press the C2 button again, it adds the current motion to the previous one. So I fly forward, press C2, that's locked. Then I add a little sideway drift, press C1 again. Now both movements are active. Add rotation, press again, and so on and so forth. After a few tries, you'll have 4 or 5 combined motions running smoothly, and you can focus on camera tilt or framing. It feels like programming a mini dolly track mid-air. When you power up the Mini 5 Pro, the RC2 display shows a clean, empty frame. Nice, but not pretty helpful. So one of the first things I turn on are the screen guides. Go to the three-dot menu, camera, scroll a bit down. You see options for diagonal lines, a center crosshair, and a 3x3 grid. Personally, I skip the diagonals. They just clutter the screen. But the crosshair helps with alignment, and the 3x3 grid is essential for composition. It divides your images into 9 rectangles and helps you keep your subject right on the rule of thirds lines. My favorite part is that top horizontal line. I always use it to align the horizon. Depending on the height and the scene, having your horizon line match that upper guide gives the most cinematic balance. Try it, you'll instantly notice your shots feel more professional. A lot of people complain about the new gimbal cover, but that's only because they are using it wrong. First, quick thing about the props. When you gently pull them apart, they lock and won't rotate. When you press them together, they loosen and can fold. Remember that it's key to making the cover fits easily. And here's the exact order I use every time. Before folding anything, place the cover over the front sensors and camera. Click it into place underneath. The upper rubber band stays loose for now. Fold the two front arms back, fold the propellers together, and rotate them forward. You see a small gap at the bottom of the cover. That's where the front props slide under. Flip the drone over, fold the rear arms in, and bring the rear props together over the body. Now lift the rubber band and stretch it over the props. Finally, hook the plastic clip into the rear vent slot. Done! It sounds complicated the first time, but after 2 tries, you'll do it blindfolded. Compared to the Mini 4 Pro cover, this one actually locks everything in place. Nothing moves in the bag, and I honestly think it's a huge upgrade. If you still have batteries from your Mini 3 or Mini 4 Pro, yes, they fit. I've tried them. The Mini 5 Pro powers up just fine. But don't expect full performance. The older batteries have less capacity, and this drone draws more power. In practice, that means noticeably shorter flights, especially in sport mode or wind. So I've read that some users even get the power insufficient warning if they push too hard. DJI hasn't officially approved cross-use yet, so I use them only as backup. It's still nice that DJI kept the physical compatibility. It shows they actually thought of existing users for once. But for maximum flight time, stick to the new batteries. So that's pretty much my setup, the way I've tuned the Mini 5 Pro. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Tell me your tweaks in the comment section. All mine are just smaller ones. Return to home, cruise control, the gimbal roll, D-Log M, they might sound minor, but together they just make the drone feel way more natural for me. So I do like when I can take off and everything already behaves exactly the way I expect it to. No weird button combos, no flat footage, no surprises, just smooth flying and clean shots. Well, and that's kind of the whole point for me. I don't want to fight the drone, I want to enjoy flying. These settings make it feel effortless, like it's part of what I'm doing, not something I constantly need to adjust. So if you fly yours on the default setup, change a few things. You'll notice the difference instantly. Anyway, that is it for today. I'm done sitting in front of a screen. You've seen what I do. Now it's your turn. Close YouTube, grab your drone, and go fly. Have a good day. See you. Bye-bye.